first loved us. Those who say, I love God, and hate their brothers or sisters are liars. For those who do not love a brother or sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. The commandment we have from him is this: those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. A very heartfelt word of thanks and appreciation to you for your warm welcome this morning. A special word of gratitude to my sister, Mantha Barbie, who I'm just delighted to have here in Atlanta. Have these miles between us, about 3-4 hours between us for a long time, for many years, even as we were kind of circulating around each other and doing ministry somewhat collaboratively. But now that Amanda is here, and as you've heard, we serve on board together, it is a real joy and boost to my heart. And I'm so delighted for the Oakhurst Presbyterian Church as you move forward in your ministry together. Grace and peace and blessings to each of you. And a word of appreciation to my wife and daughter who are here, cheering me on and bolstering me, Nina and Mia, right over there in the corner. Insights about what today was going to be like because, this will make sense to you. I've not been very chatty the last 24, 48 hours, and this is the reason why. On Thursday, I gave Amanda my sermon text entitled, and I was still writing away the sermon. Friday, writing away at the sermon, and Saturday, writing away at the sermon. And it turns out that the title I gave your pastor is not the title of the sermon. And that is a source of real anxiety. You want to have this stuff tight, you want to be all together. That is not the title of the sermon. What I was intending to do was recall one of the really standout, remarkable sermons of Dr. King. But I'm going to have to come at that from a different angle because drum major instinct, for all that it means to our culture, is just not what I can do today. So I enlist your prayers today as we consider the topic, perfect love cast out fear. On this Martin Luther King Sunday, I say we simply have got to do something to address the irrational behavior that is characterizing our political identity, our national discourse, the very nature by which we govern and do our work together as a country. Much of that irrational behavior is rooted in fear. And I want you to remember the words of John, from whom we have just read, John the Evangelist. I don't just want you to remember those words. I want you to utter those words, and you can start with me right now. popular documentary airing right now on the life of former New England Patriot football star tight end Aaron Hernandez. Hernandez had a very strong work ethic. He's a renowned football player, had a strong work ethic, great on-field success. But for all of his physical might, something was wrong. His teammates said he was often seeking attention. There was something about him that wanted the limelight. And they even kind of noted that at times he seemed unhinged. Literally used that word, unhinged. Hernandez was not popular with his teammates. He had very few friends in the locker room. And after just a few seasons with the New England Patriots, Coach Bill Belichick was threatening to throw him off the team for his erratic, shadowy, explosive behavior. In 2013, he was arrested and charged with murder, eventually found guilty, sentenced to life in prison without the possibility of parole. And in 2017, he was found dead in his prison cell in apparent suicide. After his death, it was revealed that he had severe chronic traumatic encephalopathy, which may have affected his actions and emotional stability. But what may be even more telling is this. During his formative years as a child growing up in Bristol, Connecticut, his life was characterized by fear derived from a very volatile family life. You know, the Bible has a lot to say about circumstances like these, about tumult, craziness, anxiety, and fear. The Bible has a lot to say about these things. In the fourth chapter of Mark, after a day of teaching large crowds, Jesus and his disciples got into boats and began sailing across the lake just to unwind. They'd been working hard, and they were tired, and they were just going to get in, enjoy some time on the water, cross over to the other side, eat some good food, fellowship with each other, and rest. Got into these boats, and a storm came up. And it was a bad storm. Jesus was tired. He'd fallen asleep in the stern of one of the boats. The disciples woke him, probably shouting, "Jesus, Jesus, we're about to capsize. Wake up! Don't you even care? We're about to perish!" The text says Jesus woke up, did not share in their anxiety, but he woke up and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, you know the words, "Peace, be still." Then the wind ceased. Scripture says there was a straight up calm. And he said to them, "Why are you afraid? Have you no faith?" In the same sequence of events, after Jesus and his disciples had been at sea, they dock their boat, they get out of the boat, and immediately they're met by a crazy man. A man that we would look at today as totally irrational and unreasonable. A man the text identifies as a demoniac. This man lived in a cemetery. He wore no clothes. He was unrestrainable. He had superhuman strength. And he was constantly shouting and bruising himself with stones. Jesus asks him his name, talks with him. Subsequently, he
reason of the town that something had happened. People from the neighborhood came to see. And what did they find? They found that the crazy man, the demoniac, was sitting with Jesus, clothed, dressed mighty fine, and in his right mind. This is a really meaningful sequence of events. I almost wish it wasn't kind of divvied up between the fourth chapter of Mark and the fifth chapter of John of Mark, but you know, it is what it is. But it's a sequence of events, and it connects two ways of being in the world that threaten and undermine the best of who we are as human beings: fear and irrationality. And Jesus casts them both out. Perfect love, friends, casts out fear. We read this morning from 1 John chapter 4. I like what some of the commentaries, even Wikipedia, have to say about this little section. I'm going to share a little bit with you. The author of this epistle wrote it so that the joy of his audience would be full, that they would not practice sin, that we should love one another, and that we should believe in the name of the Son of God. One commentator says, it appears as though the author was concerned about teachers who were kind of way out in left field, and John takes it upon himself to correct these teachings that were way out in left field. Such kinds of things were being taught, like Jesus was not really a flesh and blood person, that he came to earth only in spirit but not in body. And all kinds of really bizarre things were being taught in that community. And so John finds himself having to hold it together. He finds himself having to wrestle with ways of being and ways of thinking about faith that were not consistent with the mainstream teachings that he himself had been sharing with his community. John finds himself dealing in those situations with behaviors that are unbecoming of believers of Christ. He finds himself having to deal with fears among those who were part of a very new community. Not like us, we're 2,000 years old as a communion of faith. But back then, this was a brand new community. A community that always faced the threat of persecution. That faced the threat of some kind of physical violence or emotional abuse. And John himself even wrote some time earlier, disciples, if the world hates you, be aware that they hated me before they hated you. And if they persecuted me, they will persecute you. This was what was characterizing and identifying that very young, tender Christian community in the first century AD. And John's challenge was to hold them together. And how did he do that? He said, perfect love casts out fear. And friends, it's not just a matter of being timid. It's not just a matter of being temporarily startled. This word fear in the original Greek is phobos, from which we derive the word phobia. And what
Agoraphobia is an extreme or irrational fear. It's something that does not make sense, that has major power, that can force us into all kinds of action and inaction. It's unreasonable and unpredictable. And John says, perfect love casts out phobos. That is, perfect love casts out fear and all the baggage that goes with it. From the early 1950s through his assassination in 1968, Dr. King built a movement designed to cast out irrational fear and irrational behaviors that white people in this country, many, exhibited toward black people in this country. We went through great lengths as a nation to put systems and structures into place that would deny black people equal rights, equal opportunity, and equal access, while simultaneously stoking the flames of irrational fear. In the face of all of that, Dr. King equipped us with the tools of nonviolent direct action, which, by the way, I encourage you to look at. They are still applicable even today. And he taught us the essence of the gospel. Love, perfect love, casts out fear. And if you can't exhibit perfect love, exhibit perfect love just within the confines of these four walls. You can't exhibit perfect love just within the confines of the sanctuary. Perfect love is public love. It occurs in public spaces, in the eyesight and clear vision of the entire community. We would not have any record of Christ's miraculous powers of love if they weren't done in public. One of my favorite and most cherished pieces in all of American literature is Dr. King's letter from Birmingham Jail. It's literally a public statement of love and justice. I'll share with you. He says in that letter, more and more I feel that the people of ill will have used time much more effectively than have the people of goodwill. We will have to repent in this generation, not merely for the hateful words and actions of the bad people, but for the appalling silence of the good people. Human progress never rolls in on wheels of inevitability. It comes through the tireless efforts of people willing to be co-workers with God. And without this hard work, time itself becomes an ally of the forces of social stagnation. Dr. King says we must use time creatively in the knowledge that time is always ripe to do right. Now is the time to make real the promise of democracy and transform our pending national elegy into a creative psalm of brotherhood and sisterhood. Now is the time to lift our national policy from the quicksand of racial injustice to the solid rock of human dignity. Perfect. Challenging you on this MLK Sunday to organize yourselves and go public challenging you, in the words of another great evangelist, the Apostle Paul, to practice the kind of love that bears all things publicly, that hopes all things publicly, that endures all things, and that rejoices in the truth publicly. I'm challenging you to resist the inclination to be more devoted to order than to justice, to resist the tendency toward a negative peace, which is the absence of tension, than to a positive peace, which is the presence of justice. I'm challenging us to step outside these four walls, to breathe the new air out there, to help others who've been suffocating on the stale stories of the past, to breathe in some new air too. I'm challenging us to rearrange and re-engage, to check in and take up the revolution, the movement, based on the laws of love. I'm challenging us to renew our strength, to mount up with wings as eagles, to run and not be weary, to walk and not faint. Always remembering that perfect love casts out fear, and with that love, that kind of power, friends, there is absolutely nothing to fear. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Email us at newmember@oakhurstpresbyterian.org. But you are welcome.